In the seminar, we are going to discuss on Indian business, its present status, and what will be the future strategy for enhancing farmers' income or doubling our income. This is the main thing. And what I will be going to cover in this presentation, these are the things that before that, I would like to introduce myself as Dr. Kumar has already explained. Not about me. I just explain a few points about my college. As you know, as of now, we are having 31 colleges in the United States, and our college was established in the year of 2018. And this college is situated in Kishanganj, which is having a huge infrastructure. We are under development stage still, and I hope with the visionary vice chancellor and advice from different senior officers of the university, I will be able this topic has been divided into 10 subsections. This is one introduction, very brief introduction about the same subject, why this topic is necessary for the present scenario. A little bit about Indian fisheries, this overview, information about Bihar fisheries and aquatic wealth of India, why this sustainable fisheries is important for developing countries, and next one will be why does aquaculture matter for today's scenario. These farming systems existing in India, I will be discussing. Next one is farming system, role of fish in human nutrition, and role of SEUs and agricultural industries, and this ICR issues. ICR issues for the development of farmers' income. And last will be on the future strategy. What will be our future strategy for enhancing the production and productivity of Indian aquatic systems? Okay, coming to the next slide. Sorry. This is a little. This figure is overall summary of today's presentation. This is showing the present population growth rate, production of different systems. As you know, our this total system is for almost 70% by water. We are having two mega ecosystems. They are again divided into some micro and macro ecosystems. And this mega ecosystem is divided into major two parts. This land or terrestrial ecosystem, and another is aquatic ecosystem. And this 30% of the terrestrial ecosystem or land ecosystem is directly related to livelihood of this 8.5 billion. Human population, which is which will be expected in 2050, and these resources will be used for growing agriculture, crops, vegetables, fruits, and not only this, the major part of this land will go for the infrastructure development, like industries, development colonies, and road infrastructure, airports, bus, so many essential facilities has to get in. It means the resources, 30% resources is not counted.
Sir, आपका माइक म्यूट हो गया है, डॉक्टर सैनी. आवाज नहीं आ रही है सर.
ममता आवाज नहीं आ रही है.
ओके ओके ओके, नाउ इट्स ओके.
या प्लीज.
नाउ आई
स्टार्ट. यस, हां अभी ठीक है सैनी जी, कंटिन्यू.
नहीं, स्क्रीनशॉट कर लो, आपका प्रेजेंटेशन ओपन है ना. एक सर, ये तो हां ठीक है, यहां से नहीं होगा. ठीक है, नहीं इसी को ओपन कीजिए. हां सही है,
वो चला गया ना, बंद करो यार इसको, बंद कर दे।
फिर से स्क्रीन को शेयर करिए।
ओके ओके ओके, दिस इज मेन थिंग। ओके नाउ वी विल हैव टू स्टार्ट द स्क्रीन शेयरिंग। दिस इज
प्रेजेंटेशन तो नहीं ओपन,
इसको एग्जिट करो। Okay, now it's okay. I was talking about the resources, and on the other side we are having 70% aquatic resources in the form of marine waters, brackish water, fresh water, and so many ecosystems we are having. And these resources are still not used up to their full capacity. They are underutilized, though some of the reservoirs and small water bodies are overexploited because of some or other reasons. And in total, the total resources will remain more or less unchanged for a long duration for the human welfare, which can be used for growing fishes and other aquatic organisms and plants. And if we see the population growth, it was in 2005, it was 6.5 billion only. And now, as I know, 2020, it is 7.8 billion. And it is expected that in 2030, it will be 8.5 billion. On another side, if we say see the history of 70 years, so Indian growth, the agriculture growth, fishes growth, human population growth, these figures are clear. From 1915, 70 years, our population has grown from 36 crore to 135 crores. And on another side, the fish production was only 0.75 million tons in 1950 and 51. And our, this growth has gone up to more than 13 million tons from both marine and freshwater sectors. And food grain was only 50.8 million, and we were exporting from other countries. And now we are self-sufficient in food grain production. As in 1920, we have produced 292 million tons of food grains for our growing population. This is almost sufficient. Now, from this figure, it's clear that we are not having much land for the expansion of agricultural activities. We cannot go for vertical farming. That is very, very costly. And another option now we are having is development of aquaculture or related aquaculture activity in water, other growing vegetables in water through aquaponics and growing vegetable or some other species and related activity we can take up. Now, because I know some students have also joined, a good number of students have joined this seminar. I'm starting my next slide with a question: what is fisheries and aquaculture? If you simply ask any farmer or other, what we ask, what are you doing? He simply answer, I am doing fisheries. He is not aware what is fisheries and aquaculture. There is a huge gap between fisheries and aquaculture. This is basically for students. Today I will explain what is fisheries and aquaculture. Fisheries, or otherwise we can say this is capture fisheries, or culture, aquaculture, we can say the pond culture of culture fisheries. This is basic difference. And this culture fisheries or capture fisheries, this is activity simply hunting the fishes from natural water bodies. And the purpose of hunting these fishes may be for food purpose, recreational and self-consumption, or sometimes this commercial purpose may be there. These activities are mainly done for that. And here in this type of farming system, there is no human interference. They are not being to seed stocking, manuring, feeding, nothing is done. And this type of fishing is normally done in sea. From marine sector, we are harvesting only, we are not putting anything there. Likewise in lakes and dams and rivers. Nowadays, slightly there is change because of the depleting population. Considering the depleting population, we have started ranching. Even in sea, we have started ranching. In some rivers, we are doing ranching, and in lakes and reservoir, we are also stocking seeds because there is a little bit failure in auto stocking. Because of that, we have started some artificial stocking we have adopted, and because of that, that system earlier known as capture has now renamed as culture cum capture fishery. Now the new term has come, this culture cum capture, and some people for this lake is now considering as reservoir aquaculture. These terms are new terms are coming. Now aquaculture. What is aquaculture? Aquaculture, you know, that's just culture of aquatic organism, either plant or animal, or any animal for the purpose of food. There are conditions that culture should be under control condition. This is first lesson. The total control condition. Then you are just doing that for the purpose of food or trade, or for both trade and food. Sometimes we are also doing aquaculture for maintaining our natural populations, threatened species. We have to maintain our stocks and sometimes restoration of the habitat. And this type of farming systems are done either in sea using a cage system, in big reservoirs or dams. We are doing cage farming, that is part again of aquaculture. On definitely it's a major part of aquaculture. We are aquaponics again, growing vegetables, fruit, and other things. By using the waste from aquaculture is also a part of this aquaculture. Aquaponics, then raceways, doing aquaculture in running water, especially in hilly areas, these systems are adopted, and some in European countries they are using raceways. This is again system of aquaculture. This was a little bit about the two different systems we are having, and now this we are moving to next step. Why this aquaculture or fishery is so important? Whatever we are doing, either we are doing business, we are doing agriculture, we are doing poultry, we are doing animal husbandry, our ultimate purpose is to earn something from that system. Because with money we can purchase anything, either your daily needs, days, anything we can purchase. That the ultimate aim is to get something from that activity. Likewise, in aquaculture, we are doing aquaculture to get some money. Now, second is employment. As you know, if we remain active, we are not doing nothing. After even if we are not using any part of our body for a long time, long years, that will become inactive. Okay, and even mind. If mind is not, we are not applying our mind in different activity, that will be that will go on negative side. That will remain active, but that will go on negative side. That's why we need some kind of work, either part time or full time. And this aquaculture is one of the most important activity, which is providing job opportunity for near about 1.5 crore population of this country. And then third one is nutritional food. As all we know, we are well qualified about nutrition and everything. The nutrition, the fish is the best source of animal protein and fat. Fat is of high quality. Fat is supplied by fish we are consuming. This is a nutritious food. And last one is definitely is fishes are helping to maintain our health. Some medicines, biomedicines are obtained from the fishes. And you see this one in big malls and big cities and metro cities. This small fishes, this Gyra gutile and Gyra rufa, mainly Gyra rufa is used for pedicure, for removing our dead skin from our body. This type of medicine benefits we are taking from the fish. Okay, a little bit now about the global scenario. As you know, our fish growth is near about 3.6%. This is since 1961 we have taken in average. This is growing at the rate of 3.6%. While our population is growing at the rate of 1.8%. It means we are quite comfortable. Until date, we are quite comfortable. As far as the protein source from the fish is concerned, we are getting almost on an average 15% of the protein, animal protein from a fish. And fish consumption was only 9 kg in the year 1960, which has gone up to 20.9 kg at global level. This is 20.9 or 21 kg. In 1990, though in India we are still lagging behind. Our daily consumption is less than even 10 kg. Now that's not because of productivity. We are having available, but because of feeding habit and other things, they are feeding. Their per capita production is a little bit down. The per capita availability of fish and the fish product has therefore more than doubled in last 60 years. It was 9 kg in 60, and now it's around 21 kg. That's why in last 6 years we have almost doubled our consumption or availability. This is unique. This shows how the technology can change overall scenario. This figure shows how the technological inputs and our developmental plans change the total scenario. This is the last 20 year figure. In last 20 years back in 1997 and 98, our production was 69% from capture fisheries, and only 31% we are getting from the culture fisheries. And as of now in 2017 and 18, after 20 years, we are getting just, this is reverse, we are getting 68% from culture fisheries and 32% from the capture resources. It shows that our capture resources we are getting, but the proportion is increasing. The total production we are getting higher production is mainly contributed from the aquaculture. This is the impact of technological interventions, expansion, horizontal expansion of the aquaculture activities, development plan of the state on central governments and at global and local levels. This is the main picture. Now a little bit about the Indian fisheries. As you know, currently we are producing 13.7 million tons fish annually, and that is contributing 65% from the freshwater resources and remaining 35% from the sea. 13.77 lakh tons we are exporting every year. We are having surplus stocks we are exporting every year, and by exporting that much amount, we are getting 47,620 crore rupees per annum from the export of fish and fish commodities. Our growth rate, aquaculture growth rate, fisheries growth rate, overall combine of both, this is 6.8%. On the other hand, ornamental fish is growing at faster rate, that is 20% per annum. This aquaculture sector is contributing 1.4% to our total GDP, and to agriculture GDP it is contributing near about 5.3%. Okay, so now we are blessed with plenty of aquatic resources. As compared to other countries, we are having aquatic resources, but different diversified resources. We are having marine resources, we are having slime water resources, brackish water, inland slime, highly slime water, inland slime waters. We are having cold waters, every type of water which is available in the world, we are having in India, all type of water resources. We are having a coastline of more than 8,000 kilometers, and our EEZ is 2.02 and continental shelf 506, and our total landing centers in India, we are having 1,376 on now, and total fishing villages are 3,322, and our potential, the marine production potential are 3.9 million metric tons. This is river and canals. In India, we are having 29,000 kilometers, and reservoirs, we are having 3.15 million hectares reservoir we are having, which are basically created for the purpose of irrigation and other storing water, not for fisheries, but that are now used for fisheries activity. Pond and tanks, we are having 2.4 million hectares. Brackish water and lagoons, we are having 0.19, estuaries 0.3 million hectares, floodplains, Bihar and other regions, we are having 2 million hectares, and uplands, we are having 0.75 million. These are quite good amount of water sources for the fisheries we are having. Not only aquatic resources, we are having rich fish fauna in India. As you know, till date, near about 26,013 species have been identified from different aquatic resources in different countries. And in India, there are 2,319 species have been cataloged by NBFGR. And from this 2,319 freshwater species are 8,838, and 113 are brackish, and 1,368 are this marine water species. A large number is from marine sector. This is this fish patchiness, or the number of species in different zones are not equal. In India, we have mainly three hotspots. Which are considered the fish biodiversity hotspot. We are having one mega is in northeast region, another is in west coast and then east coast, and some species we are having in central India. From this northeast till date, 296 species have been reported from this region. And out of this 296, 216 species are categorized as small indigenous species, which are very important from nutritional point of view. They grow up maximum up to 30 centimeters. And 62 species are important as food, and remaining 42 are considered as of ornamental importance. Likewise, from Eastern Ghats, there are 134 species. 92 species are categorized as small, and 42 species are important for food, and 13 for this ornamental. This is Western Ghat, which is having highest number of species. This is 287 species. And the rich fauna of ornamental species, 155 species from this region of India are reported as which are having a huge importance of as ornamental species. Even the most beautiful species, this Bihadra and Sanahi, is also reported from the same zone. Okay, this is a little bit because we are from Bihar. We are basically Bihari. That's why we are have to explain a little bit about our resources. Bihar is having a quite a good number of water resources. Reservoirs, because Bihar is having a number of perennial river system, and we don't need to store water and other things. And reservoirs are basically created in those areas where water scarcity is existed, like in Rajasthan, in some part of Karnataka and Andhra Pradesh. They are creating for storing this water for irrigation and other. In Bihar, we don't need to store water for the purpose of irrigation and other things. We are having a good number of groundwater and this river water. That's why we are having only 25,000 hectares of reservoirs. Tank and ponds, we are having 90,000 approximately. Rivers, almost 10% of rivers are flowing through Bihar. Total out of 29,000 kilometers, 10% are passing through this Bihar state. Of two lakes, we are having 9,000 hectares, and our shores are more than 2 lakh hectares area. This is about the production status. We are having. Please switch off your mic. This is creating some problem. Okay. The fish diversity. We are having 88 species till date. We have from Bihar resources. And the fish production is 0.5 million metric tons. Our demand is 0.64. The Bihar is the only state which is having gap in production gap. In Rajasthan, we are having surplus. In other states, we have our production is less than our demand. The reason is that that's not because of our production or productivity. We are producing a good amount of fishes, but our this consumption rate in Bihar is higher than other states, and that's why we are there is a little small gap of 0.1 million tons in this Bihar state. We are having 97 hatcheries for seed production, and still we are deficient in seed. Because our demand is more than 1,000, and we are producing less than 1,000 seed million fry per annum. Now, moving to next section, this is why is sustainable fishery so important? Why basically, especially for developing countries, the basic reason are there only four reasons are there. Our 63% population is living in rural areas. It's very clear in India, even. Not only Indian, in any country, major population is living in rural areas. And the poor population is concerned, there's 73% of the total poor population residing in rural areas. And this agriculture and agriculture related processing industries and subsidiary industries are contributing from 30% to 60%. Of GDP of different countries, especially in developing countries. And with all development activities, with all infrastructure development, in another 15 years, more than 50% population will remain again remain in rural area, where the option is only either agriculture or fisheries activity. That's why this fisheries activity is more important for developing countries. Now, why does this fisheries matter? One option is open, that 70% water we are having. Either we have to use that water resources, or we have to keep this water bodies untouched without any use. Because for that reason, this is the main reason, because we have to use resource, plenty of resources we are having in India. That's why we have to use that for again full exploration. And not only that, there are certain other regions which are responsible, which attract the fisheries activity. One is the low food conversion. I will explain later on. Increase in fish produce, protein consumption rate is increasing year by year. Then this world production, protein production, trade and income generation and important for poverty reduction. These are the basic reasons that we are more interested about. Now coming to this low FCR, as you know, the student must be knowing that FCR means what? If we are feeding a fish 1 kg feed, how much we are getting? That is the criteria for calculating FCR, the feed conversion ratio. In case of fish, if we eat 1.25 to 2 kg, it's vary from species to species, from one region to another. Just so many factors are there. If fish is in under stressing condition, their FCR will be higher. If in comfortable zone, that FCR will be lower side. Again, feed quality is of best quality, then FCR will be on lower side. So many factors are there. But in generalized way, it is ranging from 1.25 to 2 for fish. And on an average, that is 1.5. If we are feeding a fish 1.5 kg, after 1 year, we will get 1 kg of feed. But in case of this beef, by feeding 8.7 kg, we will get only 1 kg of beef. And in case of pork, it's 5.9. In case poultry, it's almost very near to fishes. It's 1.9 or something. It's again ranging 2.2 or 1.75 is ranging. But average is 1.9 kg for food conversion ratio. And this interesting figure. If we feed 100 kg feed to fish, this pig and this this poultry, we will get 61 kg fish, edible fish. Net edible fish will be the highest amount we will get from the fish by using 100 kg feed. In case of pig, it will be only 17 kg. But in case of poultry, it's again 20 kg. It's very less, almost one third of as compared to fish. With less input, we can get higher from this fish. That's why the fish matter in our system. This is again increase in protein consumption. This is comparison of last 15 years. In the 2000, the protein consumption from fish was 28%, and rest 72% from meat. The meat, all beef, pork, poultry, and mutton and goat. This was 72%. This is another thing. Now we after 15 years, this 28 has gone up to 31. But this is not interesting. The interesting thing that here the 3% contribution was from culture fisheries. The protein which we are consuming was 3% from the culture fishery, and now it has gone up to 14%. The total scenario has been changed, both the total amount and the sector-wise protein source has been changed. And this almost remain same from both the sector. This is growing year by year. That's why in future, if this trend goes increasing, in future we will need more fisheries. That's why we have to concentrate on fisheries and fisheries related activity. Okay. Now this is another. This is trend, production trend. Definitely, this poultry is performing better from 1950 to till date. This poultry is continuously increasing day by day. But the two figures are very, very attractive. This overall fisheries production, this overall is increasing. Okay. Overall fish production, protein production from fish, both from wild and culture fish, is increasing. But on the other hand, this fish, wild fish, protein is reducing day by day. Our production is increasing day by day. The major contribution is from culture fish. This is trend. This increasing trend, so that there is a lot of potential with aquaculture activity we can take up in the future. Now, as I already said, that in India, even in India, 1.2 crore population is directly or indirectly involved in aquaculture. They are getting their livelihood from the fisheries. And this is main income source globally also. We are, this trade is only 60 to 65 billion per annum. US dollar trade is there. 50% of trade is from developing countries like India, and India is having a good share in international trade. And a major source of income and export for developing countries, 13 countries, India and some countries of Southeast Asia, are having 5% of their GDP. This the percentage is contributed by fisheries only. These are the 13 countries out of more than 200 countries. 13 countries, developing countries, are those which are having more than 5% GDP from fisheries. And this is more more attractive, that the any income from fisheries is totally license free. We don't have to pay any the production farmer is producing fish, 1 lakh, 2 lakh to put is the total tax free, and we don't need any type of license for starting aquaculture activity, farming activity. Okay, this is important for poverty reduction. This is providing this livelihood for 30 million globally, and employment for more than 150 million people. It's providing job opportunity in defense sector and related sector, and it's source of food source for more than 400 million population all over the world. Potential source for alternate employment, agriculture industry. Then this is alternate. This part time, and this is alternate source can be alternate source of employment for growing population. Now, this is a little bit about different culture system. As I have already explained, that we are having major two farming system. One is culture fisheries, another is capture fisheries or associated fisheries. Now, third modified is this a sort of culture and capture fisheries. This is culture based fisheries, and with little interventions we can increase the production from natural water bodies. This system is again important because we are having a large number of water bodies for using this type of culture system. Figures show the culture fishery. Culture fishery is again divided into two parts. This is extensive culture system and intensive culture system. This extensive culture system is having a small inputs, only the quality seed and no feeding and other things. And that, because of that, only small increases production is reported from this type of farming system. While in case of this intensive system, different type of intensive systems we are having, even super intensive system we are having. In this type system, we are maintaining the water quality, providing quality seed, providing feed, and we are managing disease, everything we are monitoring. And the production from this system is far, far away from the capture fish, type of fishery or culture, some capture type of fishery. This is now more important to emphasize on this type of farming systems. Now, these other intensive or super intensive farming systems, we can use, I will explain each and every different another slide. This is pond system. We can use this ponds for the intensive farming system, or putting some aerators or quality feed by some changing some minor quantity of water every month or by month. This can increase our production. This raised waste we can use in hilly areas. Basically, this is more important. Then cage farming definitely is one of the best super intensive farming system, which can be used for enhancing natural productivity from reservoirs or large water bodies. RAS is again a very recent technology which is developed in other countries, and now it is adopted in India, and our National Fishery Development Board is well promoting this activity. It's very important for those areas which are deficient in water. Those areas are not having water scarcity, and again those type of farmers which are not having land, this can be started with small piece of land. Okay, now pond, we start. I normally use this figure, this for pond culture. This is the thumb rule that for culturing 1 kg of fish in pond system, we need 1 cubic meter of water. That is 1000 liters water is needed for growing 1 kg of fish, and feed definitely 1.25 to 1.5 kg feed we need for this, and 1 kg manure. 10 tons of vermi manure is normally used for 1 hectare, and on that basis 1 kg of vermi manure is sufficient for growing 1 kg of fish, and one quality fingerling. And from this type of input, we can get a profit of 25-30 rupees per cubic meter. But this type of system is not a practice. This is our farmers are simply just putting some seed. They are least bother about the feeding. If they are doing some feeding, but they are not doing at optimum level. If they are using their minimum level, at least average level, they can get 2.5 to 3 lakh income in a year from small farming systems. Integration, definitely integration is actually not for whole type of production system or whole income. This is for supplementing our income or resource, using different surplus resources, which are surplus with one resource can be used for another resource. Like in agriculture, suppose we are in Bihar, Odisha, Bengal, there are some paddy fields which remain submerged. there are some ditches or canals, or even some farm can be modified, which remain water for 3-4 months. That system can be used without any harm for producing at least 300-400 kg. We can produce fish. That will be additional income. That is additional income from the paddy. And again, if you are selecting species, a variety of species we are selecting, we are not putting common carp just after planting 3-4 days. That is not going to harm. If you are stocking common carp, that will must uproot your plants. That's why if you are using some cat fishes, air breathing fishes, even major carps you can use. Or not only that, you can use this type of system for growing quality fingerlings. Okay. Now this is again this can be integrated with poultry, duckery, piggeries. So many farming systems are there which can be used as the additional income source. Here is not only additional source. If you can see the total this production cost is goes on almost 60% on feed input and feed you costing how much feed is costing. We have to use 1.5 kg for growing one kg of fish, and the quality seed, if we are using quality feed, that will cost 40 rupees per kg, and for growing one kg of fish we'll need 60 rupees. If you are spending 60 rupees for growing 1 kg of fish and after one year you are selling your fish in 100 or 120 rupees, and after deducting the 60 rupees from your this sale amount, then your labor, your water charges and electricity, watch and ward, everything, that will be hardly net saving will be hardly 20-25 rupees. We are not talking about Bihar and Bihar, we are rate is quite higher. But on an average size, we'll take from Kashmir to Kanyakumari, the average rate farmers are getting hardly 100-120 from 1 kg of fish, major carps. Okay, that's why for getting more profit, we are having two options now. Either we have to increase our production or productivity, okay, another is to cut down the input cost. We can increase our profit by two means. These are open. Those who are smart, they can cut reduction in the input cost, or those who are very smart, they can increase their production level. By doing this, we can save up to 48% feed cost and other from this type of farming. And the sale of poultry meat and eggs will be additional fish sale. Okay, this is again a super intensive culture. We are having a large number of reservoirs, about 3.15 million hectares we are having in India. And those water bodies which are having the area of more than 1,000 hectares and the depth is more than 6 meters, not less than 6 meters, that resource can be used for this cage farming. Though initial cost is very high, this is very costly, 1.5 lakh, one small cage is costing 1.5 lakhs and so many problems are there, but its production level is very high. From a cage of 5 into 5 into 3, this is 75 cubic meter, we can produce up to one ton of fish, and the total production cost will be around 40,000 to 45,000 rupees in a cycle. And from that by selling of 1,000 kg of fish at the rate of simply 100 rupees a kg. If we are normally we use tilapia and some pangas, that they are sold at quite a lower rate, 100 rupees we have taken, and by that we can earn 55,000 to 60,000 in a period of only 7 months from this cage farming system. That's why this is important, and even for reservoir is good. Species diversification, okay, definitely this is most important from if we have to increase our total production, aquaculture production, we have two options. Either we have to horizontally expand our farming system ponds and everything, or we have to get maximum production from the existing pond. We have to increase our present production that is hardly 2 tons per hectare, that we have to increase up to 4 and 5 tons, but that is not possible in case of on an average farm. With cattle or home regal, you know that there is some restriction because of their biology. They are gangetic calves. They need a large space for running and everything. That minimum space we need is 1 bigha, and every farmer cannot afford that type of system. And even suppose we are having a large pond of 1 hectare or 2 hectare, we cannot go more than 1 kg. At most, if you are exchanging water, 30% of the water every month, you are using high quality nutrients, your protein feeds, aerators, everything, chemical, disease, everything you are managing. In that case, you cannot go above 15 ton, 1.5 kg per cubic meter. But now second option is with us, this is tilapia. Okay, tilapia is the wonderful species which can be even cultured in small tanks, small cemented tanks can be cultured. It can be cultured sometime it's more than 10 kg per cubic meter can be cultured. Some aquaculturists are having question mark that the seed is not available. The seed available in market is not 100% monosex, that 100% male. I am agree that 100% monosex seed production is not possible with this hormonal manipulation. It's not possible. No one can, not in government, not private, any agency, not in laboratory can use 100% monosex seed of tilapia with the hormonal manipulation. That is only possible by new males. And as you know, the technology takes a lot of time, lot of money and time, not 6, 7, 8 years we have. We need for producing a new male. It's very, very job. And a new male, though experimental level, this is successful new male production. Technology is very, very easy. But in India, we all, even master student, PhD student, researchers, all teachers are parasite type researchers. 1 year we are doing an aquaculture, another year we will shift on pathology, another we are go limnology. Every year we are changing our field. This is only possible in such type of environment where the researcher or student decide their research field in very beginning of his career. Those who decide their career that I have to produce this new male during my master's program and I will continue this type of research for whole of my life. That is only possible. And if someone is successful, this is wonderful, wonderful technology. New male can solve this problem of mixed type of male and female. That type of system can be helpful for producing 100% male. And if we somehow we are not able to produce 100% male, as now we know, this tilapia is available in Ganga. If it is available in Ganga, no water is spare. Okay, almost all the waters are having tilapia. Then what is harm of harm with culturing this tilapia in cages and rivers and ponds? It should be allowed in our water. Even government has allowed now in type of ponds. Though they are advocating that should be cultured in controlled condition, but now it's under almost all type of ecosystems. The Meghna River, we are having a river Ganga. We have seen even in the saline water resource. This is Luni River system. We have obtained harvested thousands seed from that. Not only harvested, that is easily breeding that saline water resource of this Luni River system. This type of system we can adopt now. This is coming up. Some parts of different state is this type of system has already been started. This is RAS. RAS is definitely a wonderful technology, which is not Indian technology, though it was started in another country, and now we have adopted our. This National Fisheries Development Board is promoting this activity. They are giving the 40 ton production project. They are funding near about 60 lakh for a complete cycle input and cost of construction. And for that type of system, we need only 3,000 square meter of area. And you know, water almost 90% of water, 95%. Water is again recycled after purification. So deficit area which are we don't have much water, this type of system can be operated. And the production is 45 to 50 kg per cubic meter and return is almost 125 to 150%. If you are spending 1 rupees, and you will get more than 1 rupees in 6-7 months. Okay. Now, if we some this RS system, if we integrate this RS system with aquaponics, this will be add to get some additional income because by using the effluent of this discharge from this RS system, which is having a high amount of nutrient, the plant will be cultured on organic material. That's organic vegetables or other fruit or grains produced from this organic system. Will be sold on prime rate in the market. This will be additional benefit from this type of systems. Okay, I will discuss later on about this. This is now the role of fish in human nutrition. I will discuss about the hunger, nutrition, and health. This great problem is main for humankind is this hunger. Global population by the year 2050 will be 10 billion, and the total 925 million will be undernourished. They will be having nutritional problems and micronutrient deficient affecting more than 2 billion population. 250 million children at risk of vitamin A, major vitamin A deficiency. Equal number of suffer from deficiency of minerals, iron, zinc, and etc. And this is 925 distribution. We have given globally distributed this 925 million population, and this is basically from our Asian regions. This is 500, major part is from Asian region, 578 million population. And remaining from African countries, this is 237 and 53 from this Latin America. There is a small number, where major number is from Asia Pacific countries. Okay, this contribution of fish is in nutrition. As you know, animal protein, good source of animal protein, essential fatty acids we are getting, essential this micronutrients, vitamins, minerals, and vitamin, good source of vitamin A, iron, zinc, and calcium. This is the richness of this fish feed. And micronutrients, 250 million children worldwide are at the risk of vitamin A deficiency. Okay. And 2 million people have greater, this is thyroid-related problem, 20 million are retarded as the result of iodine deficiency. Near about 2 million people are iron deficient, likewise zinc deficiency, calcium deficiency. And this is very uniform. Dr. Dhanjay must be knowing that this Mola fish is, Mola is almost available in North, Northeast India. And this is a wonderful fish. It's, this vitamin A value is 2,680. And this Rasbora, this is considered as weed fish. This Rasbora is available almost all state of India. Is, this value is 1,477. As compared, this is big fish having only 30. This small fishes are having a good amount of vitamin which can be used for supplementing our diet. This is Mola fish, which is having the 2,680 RE 10 gram per of edible fish. And see, it's different dead body parts. This eyeball and this part of this ventral side. These two parts are contributing more than 92% of this amount. 92%. Only this eyeball is just a capsule. We are using supplementing capsules in schools and this eyeball. If it's some fish eating area, if use this eyeball, this is sufficient for supplementing deficiency of vitamin A. And another part, this part, and this is having a very less amount of 8%. This is wonderful. This eyeball is a good capsule, like a capsule. Okay. This is amount of calcium. Likewise, this Mola, small fish is having a good amount of calcium. Calcium amount is again, as compared to bigger species, this is more than 700, and this is again around 200. This is 700 is a quite good milligram per 100 gram of fish, is quite good amount of calcium available. Not only amount, the this is duty of this bioactivity, this calcium. The whatever we are eating, either milk or BB, that amount of our body is retaining, that is more important. And this calcium obtained from the fish is as compared this with milk. The almost retention amount, this bioavailability of this is milk and Mola fish is almost similar, not much different. This is nutritionally very beautiful. Now coming to our next more important, that is doubling farmer incomes in next. As you know, our present government in 15-16 has given a target of doubling farmers income by the end of 2022. This was a big challenge. I will show you how it's challenged. It's very big challenge. I think not less than other challenges. It's very good challenge. Today and now question before this SEU State Agriculture University and ICR Institute is that how to achieve this type of target. Now before going to doubling our income, we have to understand what is our current income and this production. From composite fish farming, we are producing in different zones. We have taken the average of different zones. This is 4,000 to 6,000 per hectare per year. This is from intensive culture system, not more than 15,000 production we can take. The sewage fed 3,000. This different farming system. This is the present average production from different range production from different zones. And if we talk about the state wise, this four states, this Andhra Pradesh, Haryana, West Bengal, and Punjab, they are mainly contributed the major part of fish production in India. This is contribution. This is 63% fish production of India is contributed by these all four states, like Goa and Gujarat. Their production is very less than one ton per hectare. This other eight states, they are again 1 to 2. This Assam, Jharkhand, Bihar, and our production is 2 to 3. From this is the present production, and according to that, this is much this state are producing. Okay, and this is their share now. And on the basis of production and productivity, what type of energy, what amount of energy these water bodies are receiving, calculated on the ecological basis, that they have additional production potential of this much. Okay, this production can be enhanced. This definitely we can double our present production. This is zone wise, the same picture. This is instead of state wise, this we have taken on the zone wise production. This is again the same figure. Now this is gap, zone wise gap. The northeast and this western zone are having a huge gap between their production potential and present production. We have to concentrate in two zones. This all India again having difference. This south zone is performing good. Okay, north zone is doing good. Eastern parts are doing wonderful. Their yield is more than their potential yield. Okay, they're taking much higher. The central again on lower side, but we need to concentrate in two zones to enhance the overall country production. These two zones are very producing very less as compared to their production potential. Now this is when we are talking about the doubling income or enhancing income. This is the scenario. Present our growth rate 1% from agriculture, and of last 5 years is only 5.1. 5 year average is this 5 year growth is only this is achieved. This is for 1 year. This is for 5 years. Livestock is growing at the rate of 5.1% from this again 20 this 5 year. Forestry it's growing at the rate of 3%. Fisheries both inland and marine fisheries are growing at the rate of 6.88%. And overall production this growth rate of Indian agriculture sector is 2.5 per year. Okay. And the government of India in 2006-07 had launched a mega project that was RKVY, Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, amounting near about I think 35,000 crore rupees planned budget. And the aim of that project was to enhance this the 2.5% growth rate to 4%. They were insisting 2%. And after spending a huge amount on this agriculture sector, major amount. Expenditure was on agriculture. We are not able to after 15 years. We are not able to achieve that target. We are still below 4% growth rate. And if this scenario we see with this present growth rate in agriculture, we will be able to double our growth in 99 years. Okay. Now our third, fourth generation will see. This doubling figure. Livestock, it will take 20 years. Okay, in lifespan we can see that. Forestry, 33%. Okay, fisheries on an average for inland is 13 years and marine is 16 years and average is 15 years. So, lowest in all farming system and overall production we can all agriculture and agriculture allied sector that will take 42 years, but our government has given a target of 5 years. But we have to still work hard to achieve this type of figure. Not 4%, at least at least 10%, 20% we can achieve. If we put our 100%, we will be able to achieve something. Okay. Now, what type of activities ICUs and ICR can initiate? Because both ICR and state agriculture universities are having their own limitations. State universities are basically responsible for educational programs. The research, though they are doing research and extension, but their main emphasis is on student this development of human resource, student teaching, research, everything. But even though they can contribute information, they can generate and knowledge dissemination to what they can efficiently do, and doing some regional level research for bridging this gap or production gap, the huge gap that they can bridge by doing some regional type of research they can do, and developing some product chains. And they cannot do alone any this type of activity. They have to take partnership with private farmers, entrepreneurs, industry. This type of activities state universities and ICR can initiate. This is something about the farmers' income. It's very, very tedious. There are not much accurate data are available related to farmers' income, his farmers' income, not even agriculture farmers. I belong to farming community. Even I don't know how much we are earning from our farms and every year. It's very, very typical. Okay. But Dr. Slim in 2014 has given some figures on the basis of his studies. The freshwater aquaculture, the total monthly income is near about 4,976. Annual is around 60,000 rupees. Cold water fish is 23,000 per annum. The brackish water 57. This is from mariculture, marine aquaculture. This is 56,000, 15,000 from capture fisheries, and 81,000 from marine capture fisheries. They are getting the highest from marine capture fisheries. And average production of fishers are in India is around 50,000 per month. Okay, this is now what is need of the present scenario? What we need to enhance the production? Our first target is mean aquaculture production. We have to increase. Now our production is 2.2 tons per hectare on average. National average production is 2.2 tons per hectare. We have to enhance this production up to 4 tons. We have to do something for this aquaculture industry. Quality seed production of major and diversified species. We have to concentrate on this. Diversification of species, finfish or shellfish should be introduced for commercial production systems. Cost-effective feed technologies we have to develop. We have to work on this type of sector and aquaculture as a. We have to consider this aquaculture as a major part of the this national nutritional program that will be helpful in boosting the present production of the country. Now, for achieving this needs up to this target, what we have to do? We have different options. We can try different type of options. First is invest on technological intervention, because investing anything on technology, we cannot get anything from any type of farming system. Next is production of quality seeds. Reservoir fisheries, we have to enhance definitely. Reservoirs, we are lagging behind in reservoir fisheries. Promotion of culture-based fisheries and micro watersheds, species diversification for seasonal water bodies especially. And development of saline aquaculture, we need more emphasis on this type of farming system. Taking one by one, aquaculture definitely is, I think, in agriculture sector, it's the youngest industry. It is behind, decade behind this livestock, basically poultry. We are dealing with very young industry. This improvement in breeding technologies, disease control, feed, nutrition, low input production system are interlinked with areas where science can complement traditional knowledge to improve the present efficiencies. This sort of innovations where lead by the farmers, researchers, issues, companies or government have been behind productivity gain in every part of the world. Those who have achieved something, this is because of the different scenario, different groups of workers. This is because of that. And example of technological intervention I'm giving here. You must have heard about Vietnamese catfish industry. In Vietnam, the breakthrough in catfish breeding was around in 2000 years, and complemented with a widespread adoption of high quality pelleted feed for this aquaculture system has unlocked the boon of production from that system for catfish. Vietnamese catfish production grew from 0.05 million tons in 2000. It was only 0.5 million tons in 2000. And after a period of 10 years, their production was 200 times, 1 million metric tons. Okay, this is surprising. And even even though they have not they expanded their horizontal production, the area was only just doubled in 10 years. By doubling by this area and using this intervention, they have 200 increased their production 200 times. This is a wonderful example of a technological investment on technology. This is a good example. In India, SIFA has done a wonderful job. They have developed one species that is known as Janti Rohu. You know, this Janti Rohu was basically the purpose of developing this Janti Rohu was to increase the production. Okay, increase the growth rate on reproduction, everything. So many parameter traits they have taken. The main emphasis was to increase the production. Okay, increase the growth. Okay, as compared to wild stocks. They have invested a huge amount of on that technology. They have developed this Janti Rohu through mass selection program with Norway government, the collaborative project of government of India and Norway government. And after working for more than 10 years, they have developed this species. And this species is wonderful. It's having more than 18 to 20% growth rate as compared to farm reared tilapia. This Rohu and wild tilapia is having higher growth rate. Not only growth rate, its food conversion ratio. Ratio is FCR is much lesser than normal Rohu. And the saving on input cost is 12.5. This is a big amount for 1 kg fish. Suppose you are culturing 10 ton of fish from 1 hectare and you are saving 12.5 rupees on 1 kg of fish. That is a huge saving. I said that we are having two options for increasing our profitability. That is definitely lowering our input cost, and another is by increasing production. Here we have increased our production. Simultaneously, we have reduced the input cost. Both type of reduction we have done. This is again a wonderful species. Though it's under still testing condition in some of the state, but in major state of India, it's performing well. Quality of seed. Now this seed breeding of fish, especially this Katla Rohu Mrigal, is no more science. We have started experimenting on carp breeding in 1937, and in the year 1957, Dr. Chaudhary has successfully standardized this technology. And though that was experimental, and after then 57, it took another 20 years for foolproof technology. And now this is. Foolproof technology. If you are breeding the fish, you are that sure that your fish will breed, this much seed can be produced. But the problem of this sector, because what we have to do, major role players are private sector. Okay, they are doing breeding and other things. A small number of government sector, government hatcheries are involved. Even though the government hatcheries are not very very careful about the broodstock development, and privates are no more interested in development. They are only just to take the gain, maximum production. They are not bothered about their survival, growth, and other things. This is the main problem of the sector. We are producing a huge number of spawn every year. Okay, but that is not reflected in our production system. But now the problem is either we are not producing that seed, or that feed is not sustaining our system. Something is wrong. In my view, this is because of the broodstock. We are not using broodstock of the quality. For the last 10, 20 years, we are using the same generations. We are not changing. We are not genetic stock. We are not maintaining because of the inbreeding. So many problems are there. On that part, we have to take care. We have to increase our production and productivity. We have to double our income, double our production. We have to work on that field too. We have to improve our brood stocks and seed rearing. Definitely, seed rearing. We are doing so many. This protocol have been developed by ICR, SAUs. But after that, all that, we are getting how much? 20-25% survival we are getting. Suppose we are stocking 1 crore of spawn in a hectare. After 15 days, 20 years, what we are getting? 20 lakh, 25 lakhs of fry we are getting. This is not profitable seed rearing technique. At least 20% survival. We have to fix the target of 20%. We have to standardize this technology. How we can get up to 20% of the survival of the seed. Now catfish, definitely the catfish seed is not available, though experimental basis, all magur, red singi, this pangas, we are doing experiments in laboratories. It was very successful in 1957, Dr. Sundarajan has done in Delhi University, but still we are not able to produce catfish seed at commercial level. That said, we have to do something for, not only for breeding technology, seed rearing technology, commercial production of seed, and so we have to do this. This is a wonderful resource we can use for inclusion of our agriculture system. We have to work on that field. Now coming to reservoir, how our reservoirs can be a factor for enhancing productivity. We are having 3.1 million hectare areas in the form of reservoirs. These reservoirs are producing hardly 56 kg on average basis. 56 kg per hectare per annum we are getting from these reservoirs, huge resources. However, there is a great potential to harvest 100 kg. From now we are getting 56, we can go up to 100 kg. We can get 44 additional from 1 hectare area of reservoirs. And how we can get this? These are the stable technologies which can be incorporated on farming system. First is adoption of ecological based fisheries management technology. We have to adopt that. Then cage and pen culture, we have to work on that. Seed rearing near seed. These are the three sectors. If somehow we develop three sectors, we will be able to enhance our reservoir production by two times at least. Okay. Now, what adoption of ecological waste? Now, suppose we have a reservoir which is highly infested with aquatic weeds, or another water body is having a high amount of algal blooms. But what we are stocking, whatever seed is available in the market, either this is Rohum, Regal, Katla, we are not concerned about the size, we are not concerned about the species, we are just stocking whatever number we are getting. Our contractors are taking on lease, they are stocking anything, we are not monitoring. There are some scientific approaches that we have to stock 60 mm size seed, species composition is there, this is 40% Katla, 40% this row, and 20% Miracle. So many scientific data are available, but no one is taking care for highly weed infested water body. We are stocking the same species, we are stocking the species. We are not taking care of this aquatic. We have to use all food resources available in that water body. If you are using such type of technology, we will definitely able to have a higher production in near future. Now, seed rearing near reservoirs is another option. As you know, our seed demand is 16 mm. Okay. Transporting seed of 16 mm size from the long distances, because seed rearing centers are far away from the stocking sites. Okay, if we are transporting seed, this type size of seed for long distances, that is first, that is very costly. One thing is that. Another, that transportation stress is always there. Okay, after stocking, the survival will be very less. In that case, we are stocking optimum number 700 fingerlings stocking we are. And even after that, we are not getting much production. That is because the survival rate is very less in this type of seed. To cope with this problem, there is an option. We can start seed rearing. We can transport spawn or early fry from far from away, and that can be reared nearby the reserve site. One is we can construct some nursery downstream or upstream, or some very near to marginal area of this reservoir. Or we can construct some pen systems in some grooves, shallow grooves of this reservoir. Or we can install cages, small cages, temporary cages. And if we are able to adopt such type of technology, we can definitely enhance our present production. Another is cage farming. As you know, this technology is basically used for large reservoirs which are having more than 1,000 hectare area, and minimum depth should not be 10 meters. Okay, by adopting this type of farming system, we can take a production of 10 to 15 kg from reservoirs per cubic meter. Okay, this technology, this already explained that is very profitable, and this type of technologies are well performing in Jharkhand and Chhattisgarh. They are well performing in two state of India. Rajasthan has recently started this type of farming system. This is promotion of culture based fisheries. Okay, now what we are doing in small water bodies, we are just going and hunting. Okay, for trade and feeding and other things we are doing. We are not bother about the stocking. We are not bother about the managing. We are not bother about the this feeding, nutritional aspect of it. In India, we have a large number of micro watersheds that is more than 1.8 million hectares, as I already said, shown in one slide. These resources are ideal for developing culture-based fisheries. Okay. The main production from this type of resources can be enhanced up to 500 kg. Now it's 500 kg, and that can be increased up to 2000 kg per hectare if we are able to stock this type of resources with quality seed, some feeds we use for the fishes, and some organic manure by using this, we can go for this type of systems. And species diversification. We are having a large number of seasonal water bodies in almost all states. Small, one bigger, two bigger, 1 hectare. So many water bodies are there which retain water for a period of less than 6 months. Okay. But there are some practical problems with major carp, Katla, Rohan, Rigel. They need minimum culture period of 1 year. If we are culturing these three species for less period, they will not grow up to 1 kg. Because less than 1 kg Katla is officially not allowed to capture from the water bodies in some states. Okay. Now we have another species, this common carp, wonderful species, common carp, Amur carp, and tilapia. These three species we can use for in this type of water bodies. We can go for less number of stocking, less stocking density of this species, small mandarin or feeding, even with natural feeding. The natural feed material or material coming from the catchment area during rainy season is sufficient for getting 300-400 kg from a hectare. With this type of resources, we can trap for enhancing our productivity. Okay, this development of saline water aquaculture. We are having a huge number of saline water resources. 8.7 million hectare saline water resources we are having in India. But there is a problem with some state inland state like in Rajasthan and Punjab, that there are wide fluctuations in salinity. It's sometimes 8 ppt, 5 ppt, sometimes more than 100 ppt in Hanumanagar district, you must have heard. But those water body which are having a salinity less than 10 ppt can be gainfully exploited for the production of this tilapia, and even this common carp is also a good species which can be adopted for water bodies those are having less than 5 ppt. And by adopting this type of this type of resource, we can enhance our production, add our proper production, 0.6 to 0.8 million metric ton additional production we can take from this type of water bodies. Okay, think and do something innovative for addition to income of farming community. Thank you all very much for listening me. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, Dr. Mamta, you can coordinate for the question answer session.
Okay, sir. Sir, there are several questions. First question we have from Phoebe. He's the student from CIFE. He's just asking for the reference of the graph you have used to show the contribution of fisheries and aquaculture towards animal protein production.
This figure I have taken from FAO manual I have taken. The accurate this year-wise reference I will provide on his WhatsApp number. This is from FAO.
Okay, sir. Chat mein aap khud hi questions dekh lijiye. I think that will be much better. Jo important lagta hai usko you can answer. Or sharing band kar do.
No problem, madam. Last na. This will summarize now. All.
Okay, that's fine.
Okay, sir. Then there is one student, Praveen. She is asking for the RAS training center in India. We have
RAS. Yeah. This RAS training. This NBFGR people are arranging some RAS training. Okay. They can come to Dr. Lal. They are arranging RAS training.
Okay, sir.
Dr. Rai Jada is there. He's coordinator for that program.
Okay, sir. Now there is another student present. He is asking, sir, as the initial cost of super intensive aquaculture is very high, so how can a poor farmer can cope up with that or take that technology?
Please so don't think about this higher cost. That government is providing a house amount. The NFDP, National Fishery Development Board, is giving you a subsidy up to 1 crore rupees. If you are interested to start a big project, NFDP is providing up to one crore subsidy. Okay, no problem. That is free of cost. You don't need to pay anything. You just start.
Okay, sir. There is another question from one of the faculty, Dr. Bourbon. He's asking, what is the feasibility of bioflock technology in Indian context?
Okay. That is till date in India, it's bioflock. Okay. Until and unless we this standardized regional technologies, this technology is developed in another countries, and in Indian conditions we have to standardize this at regional level. We are not going to recommend this type of farming system because it is under experimental stage in India. After 1 year we will be able to say something, because in another 3-4 months we are going to start such type of farming system. As I know, I am not going to advise any farmer to start this bioflock system. It's totally bioflock system.
Okay, sir. Now there is one question from Ms. Shreya. She's asking, can raceway and aquaponics be integrated as a most?
Yeah, definitely. Why not? Why not? We have to harness our nutrients from whatever water is coming from rest tank, that we have to harness the nutrient. Ammonia is there. We have to. What this nutrient for plant growth? What we need? Protein, there's nitrogen, and that is rich in nitrogen. We can use this RAS system. That is more beneficial for both plant and this fish. That will be beneficial. When we are integrating any system, we are integrating two systems. Both are beneficial for each other. Okay, that can be possible.
Okay, sir. Then another question is from Dr. Khogain Singh from CAU. He is asking, sir, one species like Paku, okay, has been introduced in polyculture system in India with IMCs, okay, and performance-wise, this species is very good. But how far we can go with this species in our country?
Doctor, I don't have much idea about this species. I'm not very aware about this species. Sorry, sir.
Okay, sir. There is one question from our own student officer. He's asking, sir.
Our question can ask any question in class. Why are you wasting your time here? Okay. anyways, you can ask. Okay.
What is the present or the future strategies for conserving or increasing the production of our state fish of Bihar, Clarius petricus?
Bihar production, I said the production, we are producing 2 to 3 ton per hectare. Okay, now our production is 2 to 3 ton per hectare. And our target, national target, is 4 ton per hectare. Okay, we are very near to our target. The government has initiated so many programs, developmental programs, NFTB is giving so many subsidies. In the near future, we will be able to achieve this target. Only we have to concentrate, even Bihar. The main problem is we are deficient in quality seed. We are not able to use all our resources and this chores and oxbow lakes. We are not able to exploit these resources. We have to concentrate on this type of resources. But with introduction of highly nutritious feed and other things, we will be able in near future to achieve the higher production from our resources.
Okay, sir, there is one question from Abhilipsa. She's asking, sir, she's actually working. Her research dissertation is on fish transportation problem. Okay, so she's
okay. Okay. You related to, what is your problem related to this transportation?
Sir, she's thinking she could not find any data regarding fingerling transportational mortality and their contribution towards farmer economic loss in India.
Are you compiling secondary data? Or you are doing research?
I will let some.
It was my master's dissertation actually. So it's completed actually, I'm in PhD. But I could not find any data regarding Indian conditions.
This is mortality rate. Okay. Mortality rate in transportation system is not uniform, literature is not much available. There are techniques how we can transport seed in safer condition. If you are interested,
I was actually
one of my students has done research on this aspect, master's degree. He has used some chemicals, flow oils and some biochemicals he has used. For that, we are having data. But as such, the mortality rate and different part, this transportation system and other, this is not uniform and even not available in literature. Okay, this is very, very typical to analyze this type of technique. It's vary from system to system, area to area, and even day to day, it vary. If someone is transporting today and another is required tomorrow, there will be a huge gap because of the temperature and other environmental factors. Even size and even your handling practice will also determine the mortality rate. This is very dynamic. It's very, very typical to analyze this type of system.
Okay, sir, another question is, Mr. Manmohan Kumar is asking, sir, the red tilapia and common carp very low price, common carps and catfishes. And why are not focusing on?
Definitely that this common carp and tilapia are sold at lower prices as compared to catfishes. Now, in present scenario, what is the problem? We are having a quite good number of seed available for common carp. Okay, tilapia. A lot of seed is available in India. But for catfish, even today, we are not able to breed at mass scale. When seed is not available, then how we can think about the culture system, commercial culture? First, we have to think on the seed production technology. Okay. As and when the seed will be available, we definitely recommend this catfish farming. Any more question?
Sir, there is one question from one student, Karun Yadav. He's asking, we are always talking about carp culture. What about the tilapia culture? Is this underrated? Or can it replace the carp?
Carp, listen, okay. Carp, Katla, Rohumrigal. Three major carps are our native fishes. Okay. Definitely, their production per unit production is much, much less as compared to this tilapia and other exotic species. But we cannot forget our own species. Okay, our genetic resources, we cannot lose our genetic resources. Yes, definitely, we can. Suppose you are having 1 pound or more than 1 pound, you can do this carp culture, major carp culture in 1 pound, and another carp pond, you can go for tilapia or other species. But totally, we can not replace our Indian fishes or our own fauna with exotics. This is not advisable. Okay, we have to go parallel. Definitely, if we have to increase our production, we can take our major carp in one pond and another pond we can take tilapia. We can supplement our production, but not replace in total our native fishes.
Okay, sir, one of the faculty from Gadwal, so he's asking, Dr. Hassan, he's telling me, what are the precautionary measures our college has taken to increase the production rate of reservoirs, wetland and floodplain wetlands in Bihar? Because we have a large aquatic resources here.
As you know, this college was started in year 2018, okay. And we are having our second batch of BFSC. We have not started master's degree, and we are far away from research. We have just now, we are under developing phase. Another 3-4 years, we will be full-fledged facility for research and other things. And our farm is under construction. Till date, we have not started any research activity related to this type of farming system. Near future, we will be able to give answer such type of questions, but on the basis of our own studies from this College of Physics, we are not able to answer this question.
Okay, sir. So this was about these are some of the major questions we get from all the students. Here, one question from the first caller from CIP. He's asking can we promote this indigenous fish like papda and pangba in the composite fish culture, in particular in reference to the northeastern state of the country, sir? because
this is because of this COVID we are lagging behind. We have already initiated this activity at the national level. The National Fishery Development Board has already launched a mega project of 369 lakh rupees, and we are the part of that project. Even this Gadwasu is also a part of that project. Okay, Gadwasu, National Fishery Development Board, and the FGR, the four institutes will be working on that project for promoting native indigenous fishes. We will our main emphasis will be on the development of their local germplasm, then breeding protocols, and definitely if you are able to produce their seed, that will be go in culture systems. In another four years, there will be a number of species.
Okay, sir. Yes,
sir, yes. Mr. Work?
Yes, sir, there is one more question. There is one question from Phoebe Philip. He's asking, sir, especially in the coastal aquaculture, it has, due to the climate change, it has some environmental challenge. The freshwater availability in the coastal area, where the shrimp farming is practiced, is reduced significantly. Yeah. So what shall we do to prevent this or to overcome this problem?
I have already explained one slide that there is water scarcity, or water bodies have retained water for a short period of 3-4 months. In that type of water body, we can go for common culture, Amur culture, or tilapia culture. Even we can go for extensive and intensive culture. That depends on the locality. If they are having some aeration facility, they can go for super intensive culture in this type of. If 4 months are sufficient for culturing these three species, 4 months are sufficient for marketable size.
Okay, sir. With this, you have addressed almost all the questions that we had from the audience. So, thank you, sir. Now, I would like to request Dr. Issa, sir, say something,
sir, please. Okay, thank you, Dr. Sani, and thank you, Dr. Mamta, as well. We had a very long and interesting, exhaustive presentation by Dr. Sani. He has dealt with all the aspects of production, what are the gaps in the fisheries production in India. I think this has been quite exhaustive and all. And in between, our Honorable Vice Chancellor, sir, too, had joined this talk. So I, on behalf of Bihar Animal Sciences University, like to extend a hearty thanks to Dr. Sani for accepting our request to deliver this talk under NHEP program. Thank you, Dr. Sani. And,
thank you, sir. Thank you very much for giving this opportunity to me. And thank you all, audience. For listening, essentially listening to me. If you are having any problem, my email and my WhatsApp number is with you. You can ask any question related to inland aquaculture, especially breeding and genetics. You can ask. I'm not much aware about this capture type of fishery system. Any question related to carp culture, carfish culture, breeding, you can ask any time, and I will be available on WhatsApp and email. You can too, and you are having my email ID.
Okay, yes, sir. In between, there were some queries about sharing the PPT. So in this regard, I'll just like to inform the audience that
I will post on WhatsApp. This WhatsApp group I will post. Okay.
Yes, sir. In fact, this whole lecture shall be put on our website under NHEP heading, and that link.
They must be interested on PPT, sir. And the material is much useful.
That Dr. Mamta can share that link later on.
I can see a number of my students, my class fellows, even my teacher, Dr. Right. Madam Dhanje. I would like to reveal one thing. When I started my education in fishery sector, and I come across very first research paper of my life, that was from Dr. Dhanje and Madam Dhanje on common carp.
Well,
okay, thank you very much, sir.
Dr. Sani, you must be knowing that Dr. Dhanje and Madam Rani Dhanje both were working at Palampur earlier, and so we were together over there.
Madam Dhanje is still working with us.
She is our adjunct faculty. So I also take this opportunity to thank Dr. J.R. Dhanje, Dr. Rani Dhanje, and all the colleagues and friends who had joined this talk. to make it a lively experience. Thank you very much. Thank you all. Thank you, Dr. Mamta.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Welcome. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.